Hi students, in the last class we discussed about some of the definitions like melting, freezing, evaporation, boiling. Now we will discuss again the definition of boiling. The process of conversion of liquid into gas at its boiling point is called boiling. The process of conversion of liquid into gas at its boiling point is called boiling. Next, evaporation. The process of conversion of liquid into gas at any temperature below its boiling point is called evaporation. In the case of boiling, at its boiling point. In the case of evaporation, below its boiling point. What is the difference? Say for example, I will explain another definition, boiling point. Okay. Boiling point. What is the definition of boiling point? Melting point, like that, boiling point. The temperature at which liquid starts to change into gas. At its boiling point. The temperature at which liquid will change into gas is called boiling point. Boiling point of water is BP shortcut. Boiling point of water is 100 degree centigrade. Boiling point of water is 100 degree centigrade. That means if all the water molecules present in the beaker escapes from the beaker to atmosphere. At 100 degree centigrade, then we will call it as boiling. Otherwise, if only some molecules of water, that means only surface molecules of water, only these molecules of water escape into atmosphere by absorbing of heat, not yet 100 degree centigrade. That means maybe 27 degree centigrade, 30 degree centigrade, 40, 50, 60, below its boiling point. That means below 100 degree centigrade, not a 100 degree centigrade. That means escaping of water molecules from beaker to atmosphere takes place 100 degree centigrade, then it is boiling. Escape of surface water molecules from beaker to atmosphere below its boiling point, means below 100 degree centigrade, we will call it as evaporation. Now I will discuss the differences between evaporation and boiling. Differences between evaporation and boiling. This question is very, very important for 10th class also. Evaporation. What are the differences between evaporation and boiling? So what are the differences between evaporation and boiling? So first you will write the definition of evaporation. No need to write definition. Write the definition here. Also write the definition here. What is the definition? The process of conversion of liquid into gas at its boiling point is called boiling. What is the definition of boiling? The process of conversion of liquid into gas at its boiling point is called boiling. What is the definition of evaporation? The process of conversion of liquid into gas at any temperature below its boiling point is called evaporation. So first you will write the definition. Next, evaporation is a surface phenomena. It is a surface phenomena. That means evaporation takes place on the surface of beaker, lake, pond, river, well, anything. Only surface. Say for example, this book, this is the surface of this book. Say for example, for this particular duster, this is the surface of the duster. Like that, for beaker, this is the surface of the beaker. That means evaporation takes place at the surface. But boiling is a bulk phenomena. Bulk phenomena, total. Boiling is a bulk phenomena, total. That means if escaping of particles of water from the surface, That is called evaporation. If all the water molecules present in beaker escape into atmosphere, that is called boiling. Bulk, totally. All the water molecules escape into atmosphere, that is called bulk phenomena. Next, evaporation causes cooling. Evaporation causes cooling. Evaporation causes cooling. I will explain this particular one in the experience, daily life experience of evaporation. I will explain this one in daily life experience of evaporation. Evaporation causes cooling. Boiling does not causes cooling. Boiling does not causes cooling. Evaporation is a cooling process, but boiling is not a cooling process. Okay, these are all the differences between evaporation and boiling. Now I will discuss daily life experience of evaporation. Daily life experience of evaporation. Say for example, if you observe my face, on my face, okay, due to some work, due to my voice, due to teaching, okay, some sweat on my face. You observe some sweat on my face. Okay, whenever you work hard, you will get sweat. Whenever you work hard, you will get sweat. Okay, the sweat which is present on our face or our skin absorbs the heat energy from our body. Why? The sweat particles, that means the liquid sweat particles, absorbs heat energy. They absorb the heat energy to change into gaseous states and escapes from our body. So they gain energy. That means sweat gain energy. So in the case of gaining of energy by sweat, we lose some energy. That means some cooling takes place in our body. That means you feel cool. You can feel cool after evaporation of sweat from our body. That is the daily life experience of evaporation. Daily life experience of evaporation. So we can appreciate sweating phenomena. Because of sweating, after evaporation of sweating, we can feel cool. So we can appreciate sweating phenomena based upon evaporation. Daily life experience of evaporation. Drying of cloth is also an example for evaporation. Drying of cloth is also an example for evaporation, not for example for boiling. In the water cycle phenomena, that means in the formation of clouds also, evaporation process takes place. That means rain. Okay, rain, where does it came from in the phenomena also, in water cycle also, evaporation takes place during. Next, we already discussed about sweat. In the sweating phenomena also, we have some daily life experience about evaporation. Okay, this is about daily life experience of evaporation. Okay, next. What are the factors which affecting rate of evaporation? Now I will discuss what are the factors which affect rate of evaporation. Next heading, factors affecting rate of evaporation. Factors affecting rate of evaporation. What are the factors affecting rate of evaporation? There are three factors which affect rate of evaporation. What are they? First one is surface area. Second one is humidity. Third one is wind speed. Okay, there are three factors which affect rate of evaporation. First one is surface area, second one is humidity, third one is wind speed. That means if surface area of the bowl increases, what happens to rate of evaporation? If humidity in the atmosphere increases, what happens to rate of evaporation? If wind speed in the atmosphere increases, what happens to rate of evaporation? First, we start with surface area. Surface area. We know already, evaporation is a surface phenomena. Evaporation is a surface phenomena. Evaporation is a surface phenomena. Evaporation takes place at surface. Evaporation takes place at surface. That means as the surface area increases, the number of water particles, the number of liquid particles on the surface also increases. As the surface area increases, number of liquid particles on the surface increases. As the surface area decreases, number of liquid particles on the surface decreases. Here, this is the surface. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, approximately 10, sorry, 9 liquid particles are there. Say, for example, water particles. Here, only 4 water particles are there, 4 liquid particles are there, because of it is having less surface area when compared with this one. Now, we will call it as, let us take it as an example for saucer. It is an example for teacup. That's why we prefer to sip hot tea in saucer rather than cup. We prefer to sip hot tea in saucer rather than cup. Why? Because if you pour hot tea in saucer, the surface area of the saucer is more. That's why there is a more chance of escaping of hot tea particles from the saucer. So immediately cooling takes place, so we can sip that particular hot coffee very easily. That's why we prefer to sip hot coffee or tea in saucer rather than tea cup. Okay, this is about surface area. Numerically, I will write like that. Rate of evaporation is directly proportional to surface area. Rate of evaporation directly proportional to surface area. That means this is a directly proportionality relation. That means as the surface area increases, rate of evaporation increases. Between saucer and cup, which is having high rate of evaporation? Saucer is having high rate of evaporation. Cup is having less rate of evaporation. This is about surface area. Next, second one, humidity. Humidity. What is the definition of humidity? The amount of water present in air is called humidity. The amount of water vapor present in air is called humidity. That means water present in wells, ponds, lakes, in the form of sweat also evaporates and escapes into atmosphere. Air can hold a definite amount of water vapor, only a definite amount of water vapor. It cannot hold more than excess amount of water vapor. If, imagine in this particular place, air already holds a definite amount of water vapor, that is maximum amount of water vapor, there is no chance of holding excess amount of water vapor which may come from liquid water, lake, pond, rivers, something. There is no chance of rate of evaporation. That means as the humidity in the atmosphere increases, humidity means already so much of water vapor is there in the atmosphere, so there is no chance for evaporation. So we feel sweat, we feel uncomfortable the place where humidity is high. If this particular place is humidity is high, I feel very uncomfortable because sweat does not evaporate. Sweat does not evaporate into atmosphere because already so much of water vapor is there in the atmosphere. Already a force maximum amount of water vapor. So there is no chance for evaporation. So as the humidity increases, that means as the water vapor present in the atmosphere increases, there is no chance for evaporation. That means rate of evaporation inversely proportional means as the humidity increases, rate of evaporation decreases. That's why inversely proportional humidity. This is the relation. Rate of evaporation is inversely proportional to humidity. This is about humidity. First, rate of evaporation is directly proportional to surface area. Second, rate of evaporation is inversely proportional to humidity. Third one, wind speed. Okay, what is the definition of wind? Moving air is called wind. Moving air is called wind. Okay, as the wind speed increases, that means air moving from this particular direction to this direction, from north to south or east to west. As the wind moves in this direction, it moves the water vapor present in this particular atmosphere. That means it takes away the water vapor present in this particular atmosphere. Due to this, water vapor present in this particular atmosphere decreases. So there is a chance of evaporation from lakes, ponds, wells, and also from our body as in the form of sweat. So there is a chance of evaporation. So as the wind speed increases, the number of water vapor molecules present in atmosphere decreases. So there is a chance of evaporation. Therefore, rate of evaporation is directly proportional to wind speed. Rate of evaporation is directly proportional to wind speed. Okay. Among these three, only humidity is inversely proportional to rate of evaporation. As the humidity increases, rate of evaporation decreases. As the surface area increases, rate of evaporation increases. As the wind speed increases, rate of evaporation increases. But as the humidity decreases, rate of evaporation increases. As the humidity increases, rate of evaporation decreases. If it increases, it will decrease. If it decreases, it will increase. That is the inversely proportionality. So these are the factors which affect the rate of evaporation. Okay, with this we completed effect of temperature on state of matter. Okay, effect of temperature on state of matter. Due to increase of temperature, the intermolecular space between atoms increases. That's why solid changes into liquid, liquid changes into gas. If on cooling, the intermolecular space between atoms decreases. That's why on cooling, gas changes into liquid, liquid changes into solid. So this is about effect of temperature on state of matter. In this concept, I forgot two definitions. What are they? One is sublimation. Second one is latent heat. Now I will discuss these two definitions. What is sublimation? You know already in your 6th class, separation of mixers lesson, we have an activity about regarding camphor and ammonium, camphor and sodium chloride. So in that particular activity, we have some idea about sublimation definition. What is the definition of sublimation? Very, very important. The definition is related to melting, boiling, evaporation, freezing. What is the definition of sublimation? The definition of sublimation. So for sublimation. Okay, what is the definition of sublimation? The process of conversion of solid directly into gas is called sublimation. On heating. Delta symbol is for heating. So the process of conversion of solid directly into gas is called, the process of conversion of solid directly into gas is called sublimation. Okay, can we give any example for sublimation? Can we give camphor is an example for sublimation. Take camphor in Telugu, Karpuram. Hold camphor in your hand and light the camphor. You observe that particular camphor does not change into liquid state. Only fumes are coming from the camphor. That means solid directly changes into gaseous state. What are the examples? Example one, camphor in Telugu, Karpuram. Camphor. And a second example is naphthalene balls. Naphthalene balls also does not change into liquid state. Naphthalene balls. Third example, ammonium chloride salt. What is the chemical formula of ammonium chloride? Is NH4Cl. Ammonium chloride salt, NH4Cl. Fourth one, iodine solid directly converts into gaseous states. Among all the four, there is no liquid state. If you heat camphor, solid camphor directly converts into gaseous camphor. There is no liquid camphor. Like that, remaining three also. Okay, this is about sublimation. Another definition is also there, that is condensation. This is also there in your sixth class. In our lower standards, condensation. Similarly, the process of conversion of gas, the process of conversion of gas into liquid is called condensation. On cooling, we can convert gas into liquid. That process we will call it as condensation. Condensation is the reverse of evaporation. In evaporation process, we change liquid into gas. In condensation process, we can cool gas and convert into liquid. Evaporation is the reverse of condensation, or condensation is the reverse of evaporation. Like melting is reverse of freezing is reverse of melting. So this is about condensation. Next concept, latent heat. Okay, what is latent heat? Latent heat means the amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of substance from one state to another state is called latent heat. So the definition of latent heat. So very, very important. Latent heat means the amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of substance from one state to another state is called latent heat. Okay, that means, say for example, if you are interested to change 1 kg of solid into liquid, that means how much amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of solid into liquid? How much amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of liquid into gas? Okay, like that, the definition is the amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of substance from one state to another state is called latent heat. Here we have another two definitions. Latent heat of fusion. Okay, we know already fusion is nothing but melting. What is the definition of fusion? Fusion means the process of conversion of solid into liquid is called fusion. That means change of state from solid to liquid. So definition same. The amount of heat energy. So the definition is same. The amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of solid. 1 kg of solid to liquid. 1 kg of solid to liquid. 1 kg of solid to liquid. The amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of solid to liquid is called latent heat of fusion. Next, latent heat of vaporization. Latent heat of vaporization means evaporation. In evaporation process, liquid directly converts into gas. Liquid converts into gas. That means in this particular one, 1 kg of liquid, 1 kg of liquid changes into, that means change into gas. That means definition is the amount of energy required to, the amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of liquid into gas is called latent heat of vaporization. The amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of solid into liquid is called latent heat of fusion. Solid into liquid, fusion. Liquid into vapor, that means liquid into gas, that is called vaporization. This is about latent heat of fusion, latent heat of vaporization. Okay, here very one important point is water present at 100 degree centigrade. Water at 100 degree centigrade. Next, steam at 100 degree centigrade. There is a difference between water and steam. Steam is nothing but water vapor. That means already it changes its state. Water at 100 degree centigrade, steam at 100 degree centigrade are having same energy. Water at 100 degree centigrade and steam at 100 degree centigrade are not having same energy. Between these two, which is having high energy means steam is having high energy. Okay, when you pour hot 100 degree centigrade water on your skin, the how much amount of damage is less than if you pass steam through our skin. Okay, damages more. Why? Because at 100 degree centigrade, water is converted into steam by taking off latent heat of vaporization. That means, say for example, these are water molecules present at 100 degree centigrade. They are not changed into vapor state. But by taking off amount of heat energy, by gain of latent heat of vaporization, the bonds between these two are decreases and removed and they changes into gaseous state. That means they gain excess amount of energy when compared with water at 100 degree centigrade. That means steam at 100 degree centigrade is having high energy when compared with water at 100 degree centigrade. Okay, this is about latent heat of fusion, latent heat of vaporization. Next topic, effect of pressure on change of state of matter. Effect of pressure on change of state of matter. Final concept. Effect of pressure on change of state of matter. Okay, we already discussed about effect of temperature on change of matter. What we observed that in the case of temperature, if you give temperature to solid, they absorb energy, their kinetic energy increases and the intermolecular space between the atoms in the matter increases. That's why solid converts into liquid. If you again give some amount of energy, the distance is more and more, they convert as gases. But in the case of effect of pressure, say for example, these four are gaseous molecules, they are very far away with each other, but I applied pressure on these particular gas molecules and come closer together. By applying pressure, they are come closer to together. That's why on applying pressure, the distance between the molecules, that means that the intermolecular space between the molecule decreases. That's why on applying pressure, gas changes into liquid. On applying pressure, liquid changes into solid. That means gas. If your pressure increases, it changes into liquid. On liquid, if you apply pressure, it changes into solid. Okay, very, very important bit. At 200 atmosphere pressure, okay, the pressure regarding our temperature is 1 atmosphere. At 200 atmosphere pressure, carbon dioxide gas directly converts into solid state. If you apply 200 atmosphere pressure, that means high amount of pressure, gaseous carbon dioxide directly converts into solid without any liquid state. Okay, without any liquid state. Solid carbon dioxide is called, very, very important bit. Solid carbon dioxide is called dry ice. Solid carbon dioxide is called dry ice. Why solid carbon dioxide is called dry ice? Because if the atmospheric pressure reaches to 1 atmosphere or less than 1 atmosphere, immediately solid carbon dioxide changes to gaseous carbon dioxide. That means whenever the pressure is 200 atmosphere, only dry ice exists. That means solid carbon dioxide exists. If the pressure reaches to 1 atmosphere, immediately solid carbon dioxide changes into gaseous carbon dioxide. That's why we will call it a solid carbon dioxide dry ice. Okay, what are the use of dry ice? It is useful for movie production, for shooting purpose. Okay, thank you. With this we completed this particular lesson. Thank you so much.